Good evening. I had a lovely drive down here to Dorset. It didn't rain at all. And nice to see the ewes and lambs in the fields, and spring has really arrived. And I hope perhaps you can put some of the horrors of the winter behind you. As stated, I'm on the Agriculture Committee, and I'm just going to give you a little flavour of that, and then talk more about the floods, and then we'll look at the policies. Now, the Agriculture Committee in Brussels, there are 44 MEPs on it. Only 22 turn up on any sort of a regular basis, and only 8 of them really know anything about farming, and I would flatter myself that I am one of those 8. So we have spent the last 3 years arguing about the reform of the CAP. As you know, the CAP soaks up about 48% of the budget, so of the £55 million that you put into the European Union every day, something like 25, 26, 27 million pounds a day of that goes into the CAP. So it's a fairly important committee, and you may be getting the idea that it doesn't appear to be treated in a very important way. I'm just going to give you a few highlights of the reform, and I'll try and keep it light-hearted. The commissioner put forward, his name is Dacian Chilis. He is a Romanian who has spent most of his life in France. His only experience of farming is working on an organic farm. So that's where he is coming from. He is the only person out of 550 million people in the European Union who can initiate any agricultural policies, and so he put forward his proposal for the major reform of the European Union, which was going to make it much more simple and it was going to green it. And so away we went. Into the committee came his proposal. There were 4 rapporteurs to write their reports against it. A total of 8,500 amendments were tabled, which is completely blown the records of anything in the European Union, and of course they all had to be voted on. 10.5 hours was allocated for voting on this massive report, or 4 reports. At one stage during the voting, well over half of the MEPs completely gave up because they hadn't been advised properly, so they sat there looking stupid while 400 votes were called. We then had the spectacle of the Irish Minister of Agriculture, because they held the presidency for the first 6 months of last year. It was really up to the Irish to try and keep these things moving. They may be a small country, but they do punch above their weight. They've had an agriculture commissioner in the past, and it was really down to Simon Coveney, their agriculture minister, to try and get all his 28 ministers of agriculture to agree amongst themselves, then to have a row with their commission to get agreement there, and finally to have a row with us, the MEPs, to get some agreement there. So he invited some of the MEPs from the parliament to Dublin, which is, of course, is where he lives, along with all the 28 ministers of agriculture. And to get us all going, we had a lovely dinner there, and there was an Irish folk rock band playing, and the Minister of Agriculture for Ireland got up onto a table and started dancing to help loosen everybody's tongues, and he did achieve that. And on my table were the Agriculture Minister for Sweden and for Denmark, and they started talking to each other about the reform in English. They saw me listening rather closely, so reverted to a Scandinavian language. He managed to get some agreement there. Then, of course, we had to go to the plenary session, where we had a massive vote there. It was all too much for the Vice President or the Chairman or the Speaker, whichever you want to call him. He collapsed during the proceedings. He was in a coma for 3 months, but he is recovering. So we've had a bit of interest along the way. Then to cap it all, the final problem has been that the Commission, having had apparently witnessed 3 years of democratic process, have just said, oh, by the way, chaps, we're going to institute delegated acts, it's called. We're effectively the Commissioner writing the text on their proposal in the first place, and to hell with all the amendments, etc. That is rather simplifying it, but we do have a problem with these delegated acts. The chairman of the Agriculture Committee is a socialist Italian who I actually get on personally with very well. He calls me Agnew, and I call him chairman, and that's how we go on. And we were going to have yet another emergency meeting with the Commissioner to try and flush him out and draw him out on these delegated acts. And he said, Agnew, let's stay here in the members' bar. We keep the Commissioner waiting. So it's got a little bit childish in that respect. But what are delegated acts? Delegated acts are the power that the Commission has to actually write the text and maybe vary it from what the democratic process threw up. Some of that may be justified, because when you have 8,500 amendments with all the combinations and permutations there are there, you may get ambiguities and contradictions, and the Commission have to try and take a path through that. However, there is no excuse for them suddenly saying, well, it was all agreed, and with the WTO, that sheep on the uplands, there could be individual headage payments on sheep up to certain numbers. The Commission said female sheep. Now, I know that the issue of female rights has been very strong in the Parliament these last 5 years, but I think that's perhaps taken a little bit too far. So I took the opportunity in the plenary chamber to say to the Commissioner, who was down to my left, Commissioner, which of your gang is going to lift the tails of the sheep on the Scottish hills to see whether they're male or whether they're female? And that stung him enough to take it out. So we are left now with a right old muddle, because time is pressing. As MEPs, we cannot amend these delegated acts. All we can do is chuck them out if we don't like them. If we do that, it's several weeks before the Commission will produce another delegated act, and of course, we're running into the election. Some of the MEPs are buckling under this pressure and saying, oh, well, our constituents want to know, the farmers need to know, we'll just give way and let the Commission write what it wants. Many of the others, though, are saying, to hell with this, we don't really like it anyway, it's a complete shambles. It's interfering in cropping, it's bringing in set-aside, it's hugely complicated. We're going to vote down these delegated acts, and if there's no CAP reform at the end of this Parliament, we would rather say to our constituents, there isn't going to be one, than try and defend a muddle. So that's where we are. I'll be interested to see how it all pans out. They're even talking about carrying on the process in the no-man's land between the election and when we take our seats, which is about a five-week period, when many of those involved in the process may have already been kicked out by their electorate. Very interesting, because in this country, if there's an election, it all changes really the next day, doesn't it? So that's enough of that, and maybe we can try and get a better deal here, and you'll see that in a minute. I just want to talk about the flooding, and Gwaine's put a little note in front of me that's saying Dorset hasn't got away unscathed. A nice village here called Sixpenny Handley apparently is still suffering, and one or two other villages as well. It hasn't been so bad in Norfolk. In fact, to be truthful, a winter like we've just had, I would prefer than the appalling snow and ice and that sort of thing we can get in Norfolk, where we can have some real problems. Our grass has kept going, which is unusual, and we're on plateau land. But I know it's a very different situation down here, and particularly in Somerset. And I was there a week or so ago, and I'm trying to find out what is really going on, because on one side, they're saying, oh, well, there just wasn't enough money and it's tough, we've got a recession. On the other, you've got a couple of journalists saying it's entirely down to EU directives and they're paralysing the whole process. I have had a very good look at it. And you can, yes, you can highlight the Habitats Directive and you can highlight the Waste Directive. But it would be unfair and dishonest of me to say that because of those two directives, that's why we've got the present situation. It's a more subtle process. The Habitats Directive, yes, it says wetlands are a good thing and you should work towards it, but it does state quite clearly that human life, human property, human safety is paramount. It does state that, and nowhere does it say thou shalt not dredge. And I want to be clear about this. It would be lovely for me as a UKIP MEP to be able to say, wave the Habitats Directive at you and say you shall never be dredged, but that isn't quite the case. With the Waste Directive, yes, the default situation is that anything that's classified as waste must go to landfill. However, when this came in, farmers and everybody else had the opportunity to fill in a form for exemptions, which the Environment Agency would have done for dredgings, and to date they have had no problem in getting rid of dredgings anywhere. The big problem for them, though, is the hassle of the paperwork. They have to fill in forms to say exactly what they're going to do, and if they come across any problems, you know, can we put the muck over 3 metres over there, etc., etc. They need to employ a compliance officer, and it's the get up and go that we farmers like to be able to. There's an opportunity to do some dredging there. Let's get on with it. You know, I'm sure the farmers of you know the feeling. We can do this today if we get on with it. They can't work like that now in the Environment Agency. They've got to get somebody to agree to it all and tick the right boxes. So what has been going on? 40 years ago, we all understood that if you kept putting silt into a river through your human activities, every now and again you would have to take it out, and if you didn't, you would get problems with flooding. And so nobody disagreed with the principle of dredging. But in the last 40 years, we have had another dynamic coming into it. The anti-dredging fraternity, the greenies, the people who now are starting to tug at the sleeves of government ministers and saying, look, dredging's a bad thing. You're going to kill this species, that species, and the other species. You're going to make these riverbanks look like an ugly great scar across the valley bottom. All these problems you're going to do, we're going to, we think you should make these SSSI special sites of scientific interest, when in fact they're main drainage channels and really have to be looked at from that point of view. Now, these people are very influential. So at the bottom end of the scale, you've got the IDBs, the internal drainage boards, with their farmer members who have stakeholders. They're advised by water engineers. They were the people who in 2000 said we must drain the mouth of this River Parrot. That River Parrot's unusual in that the velocity of the water going out on the tide is less than the velocity of the water when it comes back in again. That means that silt never really gets out properly into the Bristol Channel, so it builds up in the mouth and starts going backwards. So every time you get a really wet event, you put more silt in, it can't get rid of it, the whole river starts to build up. So each time it's a little bit worse than the last time, and you've got less and less river to deal with the whole thing. It really is a nightmare. So they wanted to dredge it in the year 2000. And it was going to cost £4 million. And they could only raise £1 million. The reason for this is that the priorities have been displaced. What once everyone realised, and those who lived down there, was very important to get these rivers dredged. Now, because of all the sleeve tugging and the greenies at the top there, it's being put down the scale. So we find, we give £22 million to Bangladesh to sort out their railways, of which only 10% was spent on any railways. We have NGOs building so-called dams across valleys in Africa, which are the thickness, they're just bricks, like brick wall of this, they're just like that. I mean, madness, the water builds up and knocks it straight down. We're wasting money like that, whereas we should be spending it on sensible projects here. So I look at my pet phrase now for what's going on and the way that policies are shaped is that townies are being led by greenies. 100 years ago, we had lions being led by donkeys. It's very similar. We could sort this out. Yes, you may say, well, what's doing this? You've got two elements to this. You've got the amount of water suddenly arriving in these river valleys. Well, that's because we keep concreting and building, so the water, which will always go downhill, is accelerated by all this concrete, so it's arriving more suddenly, and it's accompanied by silt. Well, there's farmers can be responsible for some of that, but also, whenever you drive through any county now, look at the JCB diggers making new roads, all the new houses, they're digging up soil and leaving it exposed over the winter months, and the rain starts to wash that down. And the silt fraction moves very easily, so our human activity is doing this, but we need houses to live in. 4 million people have arrived in Great Britain in the last 10 years. They need houses. That's because of the immigration policy. And of course, we need to farm our land. We could, I mean, I've been thinking about this. I was a soil and water conservation man in Rhodesia 40 years, whenever it was, in the mid-70s. And I'm thinking to myself, well, hedges planted on contours with banks, some grass margins as well along there would make a great deal of difference. The things we could do without dramatically changing things. Right, let's talk about the policies. Are we up there? Okay, these are the individuals who got together to see if we could produce our own agriculture policy. As you know, when we joined the EEC in 1972, we went to this CAP, Common Agricultural Policy, and I would be the first to admit, for the first 12 years, it was a bonanza for farmers. Every year, there was a guaranteed price that went up for unlimited production of many, many commodities, and at the same time, as it happened, technology was coming in, and I saw wheat yields double in the space of 5 years, and from 1984 onwards, it's 72 to 84, it went like that, as far as farmers' opinion of it went. 84 hit this plateau, really, or peak, and then it's been on a bit of like that ever since. And now we've got to the CAP reform I'm talking about, where they're trying to get a policy for 28 countries that ranges from farming 200 miles north of the Arctic Circle in Finland down to the bottom corner of Crete. You're looking at 550 horsepower tractors in my part of the world to a couple of clapped out old draft oxen pulling a wooden plow on some island in the Mediterranean. You cannot get a common agricultural policy for that lot, throw into the mix the completely different attitudes to animal welfare, and really the thing is impossible from the start. So we've had a look at this. If we become independent, we will need our own agricultural policy. And so what are we going to do? Well, what's the first thing I do want you to have a look at this. 20 years ago, that was a true statement. It isn't a true statement now. So please, please do not use it. The whole thing changed with the McSharry reform. Up until the McSharry reform, the consumers subsidised the price of food. There were guaranteed levels for farmers. You had to pay these prices. After that, money was given to farmers and their produce traded pretty well at market values. So that system, the new one, has been supported by the taxpayer. Now, whilst all taxpayers are consumers, not all consumers are taxpayers. This system, I mean, I've got to be honest about this, it actually works the other way. Because if you give farmers a lump of money every year, in theory, they can afford to take a little bit less for their product. In theory. The supermarkets, of course, get in the way of all of that. So please don't talk like this. Our party started in 1993. This statement was already a year out of date then. So don't use it because it makes us look silly. It makes us look silly. What is going to be the big driver for food prices in the future? What is going to be the big driver? And without a shadow of doubt, it's this word, volatility. We've all seen in the last 7 years massive hikes twice, where they call it spikes, in the price of cereals, and we've seen sugar go that way as well. We are getting to a situation where world supply and world demand, world consumption, are in balance. And if there's any perception there's going to be a shortage, up go the futures prices, and then everything else follows that. They tend to overreact, to overreach themselves, but nevertheless, they don't usually get it wrong, and they do indicate that things are going to be volatile. That's what we're going to have to live with as farmers. It is as simple as that. And if we have to keep paying up, if that's what the price is, that is what the price is, and the consumer will have to pay it. Now, what I'm going to say now has been signed off by the NEC, this particular block. Well, the first one we wanted to get sorted out was agricultural support, because you talked a lot of farmers about the European Union. They say, well, yes, Agus, we agree with you all about the lack of democracy and all the rest of it, but what about our single farm payment? If you look at our accounts and you take that out, we will all be making a loss. We can't leave the European Union. What they don't seem to understand is that the government that takes them out can have its own agriculture policy and can support farming. And consider that we always did, right up until the day we joined the European Union, we supported farming in this country through a system of deficiency payments, which we can't use now because of World Trade Organization rules. But supporting agriculture is not alien to this country. We have always done it in what we might call the civilized past. Why do you do it? Well, you need to keep farmers on the land. If you get 3 years, a very good harvest across the world, the price slumps. And although you've had a good harvest as a farmer, and we've all seen this, although you've had a good harvest, the price is so bad that yields times price doesn't cover the growing cost. If that was to happen 2 or 3 years running, people would simply walk off the land, the bank manager wouldn't lend them the money. We don't want that to happen, because year four could be the year when there's a world bad harvest and then the food is needed. And unlike a bicycle, you can't put off getting another, your next meal for 4 months. You know, you can manage without a bicycle perhaps, but you need to eat. 5 missed meals consecutively and there is anarchy. So it's every government's responsibility to make sure that there is enough food produced. And don't forget, if we were to say, well, let's just import it all, you know, to hell with the subsidy, we just import it all. It would come in through 4 main deep water ports and Heathrow. We've seen what international terrorists can do. One limpet mine, whatever you call it, on one 60,000-ton boat in Southampton detonator would put that 60,000-ton boat down to the bottom. They've only got to threaten it to do it again. No boats would arrive. We have this just-in-time philosophy here of never having big stocks. There would be total chaos. We'd be so vulnerable to that. We must have food security. So, as I said, we've all supported agriculture, and look at this. The EU supports it, the USA supports it, the EU uses a single farm payment, the US uses something called cyclical payments. The term's just gone out of my mind. Counter-cyclical payments. Canada uses a crop price insurance policy, and Japan has supports their farmers. So other people are doing it. Other people are doing it. If we're going to do it, what are we going to do? Are we going to say, well, we hate everything about the EU, so we can't possibly have their scheme, and then try and get involved in some of these? And we have decided to be pragmatic, and we are going to adapt the single farm payment system ourselves to suit our own requirements here. It will be a comprehensive all-in policy. There will be no modulation, there'll be no cross-compliance, no cropping interference, no set-aside, no pillars, no axes, no co-financing, no digressivity and no disallowance. All these funny words have come into our language from the EU bureaucrats. However, in order to qualify this, the land must be farmed to ELS standard, and a grass farm would automatically qualify for that. The arable farmers here will be presumably in ELS schemes, they're not that onerous, but they do stop wall-to-wall wheat. You have the margins, the bird plots. It seems to work quite well, and we invented that in this country. That was what we invented, the ELS, and so we know it works. What are we going to pay?
Sorry, excuse me, may I interrupt? What does it actually stand for?
I beg your pardon. It stands for entry-level stewardship. Righto, sorry, I thought the farmers in here would have known that. I beg your pardon. Okay, entry-level stewardship. It is a stewardship scheme, a countryside scheme. Right, it's £80 an acre we're going to pay on the lowland. There are three land classifications in this country. I think all of you, perhaps not Dartmoor, but you, nearly everybody here would be on the lowland, the arable one, which pays the most at £80 an acre. The other ones would be pro rata less, the same way they are treated at the moment. Now, we are going to cap this at £120,000, which is 1,500 lowland acres. Now, the idea of this is twofold. The first is that we feel the whole idea of this payment is to keep farmers on the land in bad times. We don't want them walking off it. We feel that £120,000 is enough to keep a family farm there. Now, any more than that really is a little bit wasted. Those farmers do have the advantages of scale. There's no two ways around that. And so we've capped it. Anyone with 1,500 acres is going to be upset. And we're not expecting to save money on this. What we want people to do, if they've got, say, 2,000 acres, they're going to have 500 with no subsidy, is either to say to their son, to whom they've been saying for the last 30 years, one day, son, all this will be yours, to actually put some of that into action. Because if they give him a tenancy on 500 acres, he will be able to claim the single farm payment on that. Likewise, if they've got a foreman or a shepherd or anyone like that, these people can get a start in farming. That's partly why we're doing this, because what's worrying about this scheme is that it's accruing to fewer and fewer and fewer people as the years go by. The WTO does allow some headage payments, and to try and stimulate agricultural activity on the hills by paying them a subsidy per head, as long as it's got to be right for the land and not this business of pile them high that we used to have, that there would have to be advice on that, but that will help keep them there. It is better to have people on the hills being subsidised and behaving well than abandoning the hills, going down into sort of shanty towns, to put it rather crudely, around the capital, living on benefits where there's crime. It's better to disperse people. They live a lot better like that. So there's a social element to it. Now, we want to target this at risk takers. You'll have heard of slipper farmers. In this, as you know, in England, it's an area-based system. You have to claim against all of the different fields that you've got. In Scotland and Wales, they're still using the historic scheme. So if your old Uncle Ben had 40 suckler cows or something between 2000 and 2002, he is entitled to claim the average of his subsidy of those years forever, even if he's farming or even if he isn't. And they're called slipper farmers, and we want to stop that. Okay, so they've got to be risk takers. Those of you who are farmers, try and imagine the form you fill in every March or April, another column down the side, which will say, are you taking 90% of the risk of the economic activity on this land? And if you're not, you can't get the subsidy. We want to try and make sure this is going to people who risk money in producing the food. That is what we're trying to do. It is not an artificial pension for somebody. There will be a negative list, airports, golf courses, these things where people say, well, it's grass, so sheep can graze, we want the subsidy. No, the primary use is for something else, they can't. We're not, as you know, UKIP does not like wind turbines. They represent the worst energy policy any country's ever had to put up with. Mm-hmm. They do lots of subsidies, so 25 yards around the base of a wind turbine will be an ineligible feature. I'm sure you're familiar with that. They put the coloured green on the maps, so we will do that. Now, the other side to what we're doing, we can do some deregulation, because in the last 20 years, farmers have been subjected to quite unnecessary regulation, which is not rooted in reality. This electronic individual identification of sheep is compulsory now, and it's a cross-compliance thing. If you don't get it right, you can lose large amounts of subsidy. The problem with it is that the technology isn't good enough to work out in the open and wet and windy days, etc., etc. There is no, we will not, if you want it for management purposes, fine. We will not make that compulsory. We will want double tagging just with a flock number, and that's it. Individually, there's 17 million sheep in this country. It's silly to try and do that. Silly to try and do it. This one, for the arable farmers, the EU, 5 or 6 years ago, said, we want all pesticides to be re-registered that were first registered in their member states whenever, before a certain date. Now, I would expect in Eastern Europe, some of the pesticides produced there, if any were, may not have been registered very well, and somebody may have passed somebody a brown envelope to get the thing registered. But we did the job properly here. We did the job properly. And we have a number of pesticides now that have small volume sales, but they're badly needed by the people who do need them. However, everything has had to be re-registered at huge expense through this EU scheme, and the manufacturers of a lot of these materials have looked at them and said, well, it's going to cost us X to re-register, and we are only going to get X minus 10 of sales to try and cover it, so we're just going to withdraw them from the market. We're not going to re-register them. Well, we can turn that round. If they were good enough for us 10 years ago under our own strict rules, then they're good enough in the future and they can come back. So Azulam for bracken control, which is becoming a major problem in the hills now, that can come back, as well as a number of pesticides for horticultural crops. So what's happening in the horticultural industry is that people find they cannot grow these crops because they can't get these special herbicides, etc., so pesticides. And so we then import the product, which has had these things sprayed on it, in the country where it was grown, mad. So we will stop that. It was good enough for us before, it's good enough now. And this business of you mustn't bury fallen stock, I mean, you know what's happening. Either you have to invest in an incinerator, they cost at least £10,000 and they burn up fuel, or you have to pay now, I think, £60, isn't it, for NUPSCO, whatever they're called, to take them away, go into a lorry where they're carted 60 to 100 miles across the countryside, then roasted in an incinerator. You talk about global warming. There's lots of places you can bury these, a lot. Obviously, you can't bury them near watercourses or above boreholes, wells, etc. But there are a lot of places that you can, and we should be doing it. Badgers, foxes, deer, they all lie where they die. They're not even buried. It's not really a terrible thing to bury these livestock. Right, more deregulation. Now, this has been an absolute scam. Most people now have been, I would say, brainwashed into believing that white asbestos, the cladding on many of your buildings, is there something latently dangerous about it. It is no more dangerous than talcum powder. It is virtually identical to talcum powder in its chemical makeup. It's unfortunate that it has this word asbestos in it, because it then gets confused with blue and brown asbestos, which are very, very dangerous indeed. However, they're all lumped together, and you are led to believe that you've got incredibly hazardous materials on your farm, it's going to cost a lot to get rid of it. Well, we will simply take white asbestos cement out of that. It will be no worse than rubble. It's an absolute scam. I had a building, a grain store with a fan on the back of it, that had its own fan house, that had asbestos white as a cladding, but inside the very dangerous blue asbestos as a soundproofing. So my landlord said, Stuart, that's got to go. He got a quote for this lid, no bigger than that corner of that room there, £18,000 to take this lot away. Gosh. He said, I can't make you pay that. He then had another go. Somebody said they'd do it for £7,000. So there's real profiteering going on here. If you get trouble with this, please get hold of me. I can put you in touch with somebody else. There's a lot of bullying. You don't need to pay all this sort of money. Now, in my part of the world, NVZs, nitrate vulnerable zones, are becoming a big issue. Every year, it seems, or certainly every few years, the rules tighten up on it. How many of you farmers here are in a nitrate vulnerable zone? Oh, yes, so you're familiar with what I'm talking about. it's virtually all of Norfolk now in this, and the EU say you've got to have this groundwater down to below 50 milligrams per litre of nitrate, 50 milligrams of nitrate per litre of water. Our old rule was 100. There were never any problems with that. You know if you've got a problem because women start having blue babies. That's when you know you've got a problem. I mean, not that blue, but a bluish. Bluish. Well, we never got that problem at our... but we halved it in Norfolk and in East Anglia, in East Midlands. The water naturally, because of the fens, etc., is between 50 and 100. So it's very, very difficult for us to get it down. So the EU are threatening the EA with the Environment Agency with infraction proceedings, and slowly the screw is tightening. Less muck can be put on, close periods get longer, more and more record keeping. Because the NFU did a big survey a few years ago to try and find out what we would need to do to get down to 50, and the answer came back, you will have to have about a third of the East Midlands and half of East Anglia as ungrazed set aside. Well, that is ridiculous. But we're moving that way. This IPPC, not to be confused with the IPCC, they are two different things, you get used to all these things. This is something about pollution control. The livestock units never should have gone into this. It's cost pig and poultry farmers a great deal of money, and we would simply take it out. And on the NVZ, we want to get back to science. We want science to lead this. We know we can make this easier for farmers. We may not be able to get back to 100 everywhere, but we can certainly make a difference. Now, this is the important here. There are two emotive issues around animals at the moment. One is culling of badgers to control bovine TB in cattle. As you know, badgers are an alternative host to this, and because of their habits, they get close contact with cattle. The farmers of you here will know this, but a diseased, these badgers like to have communal latrines, and where they do their business, the grass grows and the cattle come and graze that, and an infection goes across. But also farmers make maize silage, which is the best thing badgers ever thought. That is manna from heaven for them. This maize silage will keep a pregnant sow going right the way through the winter. She'll give birth to healthy live young and lactate, all because of maize silage. So their numbers are growing. And of course they will go to where the maize silage is, and a diseased badger will snuffle them into the bottom of a trough, and a cow will come and lick that. And that is what is happening, okay? I know they're lovely, furry, cuddly and all the rest of it, but they're not actually that pleasant at close quarters. So they are a problem. Now, you can't cure this TB. You can't cure it. So no point in vaccinating a badger that's got it. It can take 4 years to kill the badger. It starts off to rot the lungs, then it starts to rot the digestive system. They're in great distress. In the end, their setmates spot that, see there's something wrong. Their setmates then eject these animals, who then go stumbling and blundering into another set, infect other badgers. We have got to put a stop to it. The cost of continuously compensating farmers for TB is going up and up and up. We have to get real with this. Now, in Ireland, they have been brought face to face, because that's a much smaller country, a much higher ratio of cattle to people, and they needed a bailout. They went very, very short of money. They couldn't afford to keep paying farmers and tolerating badgers at the same time. They've gone into culling badgers big time, and they're bringing down the TB. There is no other way, unfortunately. I will talk to people who like badgers afterwards if you want me to. Now, we realise that this is emotive. We understand that. We are the only party that can ban live animal exports for slaughter, and we will ban it. That is an emotive issue as well. So you take the two together. There is the problem with this is that, as I mentioned earlier, there are different attitudes to animal welfare across the European Union. Basically, the further south and the further east you go, the less interested they are in it, because they were treated worse than animals by the Soviet Union 20, 30 years ago. So they couldn't care less if a chicken was in a battery cage. They're really not very worried about that. You could say, well, why can't you register some abattoirs in northern France and Belgium under the tractor scheme and all the rest of it? You could do that. However, I've seen what happened in the horse meat scandal. You can't trust these foreigners, to put it crudely. They will simply use these abattoirs as a staging post to take these animals further. I don't like the idea of any sheep of mine ending up in some backyard abattoir in the northern suburbs of Paris to be ritually killed by somebody mumbling prayers over it with a very blunt knife. We don't need to do that. It's much more efficient anyway to export the meat. It's 45% of the weight. is less risk. You have a refrigerated vehicle. Taking these animals live is always a worry. It's always a worry. And in any case, it's being frustrated by people at the ports. I try and convince the NFU that they can pay £100,000 a year to a PR chap, but while they want this, all that's wasted. You know, we can ban this, and we will it. So we will. So if you love badgers, just think that we can do this. The hunting with hounds, that's a fairly old UKIP policy that's based on local referenda. The status quo actually is wonderful. It's banned, and yet more people are doing it than ever before. So again, if you're on the doorstep, I mean, I was frightening Mrs. Park's grandchildren here, or one of them, and people worry about the badgers, please go back. Please keep talking about bracketing the two things together. Now, if you were to go to Heathrow or Gatwick Airport and 3 or 4 in the morning, any morning during the week, and possibly even on a Saturday, you see people staggering off, claiming their luggage off the luggage belt, staggering away with these bulging suitcases, dripping body fluids all over the concrete. If you open them up, they'd be full of snakes and dead monkeys. Well, I know some people like to eat these things, and it's politically correct not to criticise it too much. As far as we're concerned, it really is potentially very unhealthy. We want to put a stop to this. And to hell with political correctness, you know, this could start off a major health epidemic. Because we don't eat it, I know, but those who do, there'll be wastage, and then wastage can then get fed to animals somewhere, illicitly feeding pigs with swill, etc., etc. So we want to have a really good go at sorting that out. Rural crime, we want police commissioners in each county to recognise your farmers, your local farm watch groups. We've got a good one in Norfolk. We each pay 100 quid a year to it, that's all. And they are the eyes and ears. They keep feeding information to the police, who never will feed information back. We want these police commissioners to cooperate properly so that we can reduce crime with that level of cooperation. Ragwort, as you know, when it's like that, it's okay. When you mow it, the starches in it break down to sugars, it becomes palatable, and things can get poisonous. It wouldn't be a bad idea to get a few prisoners pulling it, or some community service. You might even get interests of prisoners to get a PA1 knapsack spray thing and go out late for when it's in the rosette stage, and they then realise they actually do something with their lives. Now, we're going to as you know, the UK Independence Party, while it doesn't deny the climate changes, as it does, it always has done, we do strongly object to the fact that this is driven by the levels of carbon dioxide in the atmosphere. We feel that only has a very minor effect. And we know that human beings have very little control over the amount of carbon dioxide there is in the atmosphere. One volcano's got to blow somewhere, and all the efforts you made are just kicked into touch. Okay? That is creating this very expensive energy policy, and everyone is supposed to be reducing their carbon footprint. You are farmers, and you will all know that the more CO2 there is, the faster your crops will. Right. Well done. That's exactly how it happens. I've said to university students, try this. Two tents, two where you can control the atmosphere, have an enriched carbon dioxide atmosphere in one and ordinary air in the other. What will happen if you grow plants in each? The one where there's more carbon dioxide, the plants will grow faster. That's how they react to it. But the whole thing is a complete scam, in my opinion. I've taken a lot of interest in it. I was a believer 28 years ago when I went to the University of East Anglia and was told that in 30 years' time, sea levels would have risen by at least a metre. At least, but probably 5 and maybe 10. And there were pictures of my county, which is fairly low-lying at the margins, how its shape changed and it reduced in size. And I changed my farming system and grew durum wheat because we were going to get that sort of climate. Nonsense. It just hasn't happened. There's been no warming for 17 years, and yet the European Union push this policy. We will simply repeal the Climate Change Act, and we have plant breeders. If the climate does change, we can easily adapt to it. No new subsidies for energy farming. We'll probably have to honour the existing contracts. As you know, ineligible areas for these. I've got 220 acres of wind solar panels going up right next to my house. 220 acres! That landowner there is going to get £1,000 an acre. So he's got an income for doing absolutely nothing. £220,000 an acre. £220,000 a year for having those things there. From the day one, from minute one, they become less efficient. because the dust accumulates on them, the birds drop their messages on them, we have a fen blow and all the rest of it. You can clean them, but the next day they get less and less efficient as time goes by. So redundant wind turbines, the owners are going to have to sort this out. We've got some toppling over in the fens now as a result of the rain we've had this winter. So a complete change of climate, if you see what I mean, and our attitude to it. And that is it, because the others haven't gone through the NEC. So I'd just like to finish up by saying we've got an election coming up in 77 days' time, or something like that. Please ask yourselves four questions. Do you really want to put £55 billion a day into an idea, a concept, a union that doesn't know how to look after the money? Do you or not? Do you want to keep doing that? Yes or no? Do you want to keep putting £55 billion a day into that?
No.
Right. Do you want 75% of your laws made by people you cannot elect or dismiss? Do you want that? You want that? Right? Do you want uncontrolled immigration where 480 million people can come here whenever they want, irrespective of their health status, if they're carrying infected diseases, irrespective of whether they're running away from debts, and irrespective of whether they've got a criminal record as long as a mile? Do you think that's a good idea?
No.
And do you think it's a good idea to have the most expensive energy policy in the world?
No.
Right, well, there's only one way you can vote. Thank you very much. Good evening. I had a lovely drive down here to Dorset, it didn't rain at all, and nice to see the ewes and lambs in the fields, and spring has really arrived, and I hope perhaps you can put some of the horrors of the winter behind you. As stated, I'm on the Agriculture Committee, and I'm just going to give you a little flavour of that, and then talk more about the floods, and then we'll look at the policies. Now, the Agriculture Committee in Brussels, there are 44 MEPs on it. Only 22 turn up on any sort of a regular basis, and only 8 of them really know anything about farming, and I would flatter myself that I am one of those 8. So we have spent the last 3 years arguing about the reform of the CAP. As you know, the CAP soaks up about 48% of the budget, so of the £55 million that you put into the European Union every day, something like 25, 26, 27 million pounds a day of that goes into the CAP. So it's a fairly important committee, and you may be getting the idea that it doesn't appear to be treated in a very important way. I'm just going to give you a few highlights of the reform, and I'll try and keep it light-hearted. The commissioner put forward, his name is Dacian Chilis. He is a Romanian who has spent most of his life in France. His only experience of farming is working on an organic farm. So that's where he is coming from. He is the only person out of 550 million people in the European Union who can initiate any agricultural policies, and so he put forward his proposal for the major reform of the European Union, which was going to make it much more simple and it was going to green it. And so away we went. Into the committee came his proposal. There were 4 rapporteurs to write their reports against it. A total of 8,500 amendments were tabled, which is completely blown the records of anything in the European Union, and of course they all had to be voted on. 10.5 hours was allocated for voting on this massive report, or 4 reports. At one stage during the voting, well over half of the MEPs completely gave up because they hadn't been advised properly, so they sat there looking stupid while 400 votes were called. We then had the spectacle of the Irish Minister of Agriculture, because they held the presidency for the first 6 months of last year. It was really up to the Irish to try and keep these things moving. They may be a small country, but they do punch above their weight. They've had an agriculture commissioner in the past, and it was really down to Simon Coveney, their agriculture minister, to try and get all his 28 ministers of agriculture to agree amongst themselves. Then all we can do is chuck them out if we don't like them. If we do that, it's several weeks before the commission will produce another delegated act, and of course we're running into the election. Some of the MEPs are buckling under this pressure and saying, oh well, our constituents want to know, the farmers need to know, we'll just give way and let the commission write what it wants. Many of the others, though, are saying, to hell with this, we don't really like it anyway, it's a complete shambles, it's interfering in cropping, it's bringing in set aside, it's hugely complicated, we're going to vote down these delegated acts, And if there's no CAP reform at the end of this parliament, we would rather say to our constituents, there isn't going to be one, than try and defend a muddle. So that's where we are. I'll be interested to see how it all pans out. They're even talking about carrying on the process in the no man's land between the election and when we take our seats, which is about a 5-week period, when many of those involved in the process may have already been kicked out by their electorate. Very interesting, because in this country, if there's an election, it all changes really the next day, doesn't it? So that's enough of that, and maybe we can try and get a better deal here, and you'll see that in a minute. I just want to talk about the flooding, and Gwaine's put a little note in front of me that's saying Dorset hasn't got away unscathed. A nice village here called Sixpenny Handley apparently is still suffering, and one or two other villages as well. It hasn't been so bad in Norfolk. In fact, to be truthful, a winter like we've just had, I would prefer than the appalling snow and ice and that sort of thing we can get in Norfolk, where we can have some real problems. Our grass has kept going, which is unusual, and we're on plateau land. And I know it's a very different situation down here, and particularly in Somerset. And I was there a week or so ago, and I'm trying to find out what is really going on, because on one side they're saying, oh well, there just wasn't enough money and it's tough, we've got a recession. On the other, you've got a couple of journalists saying it's entirely down to EU directives and they're paralysing the whole process. I have had a very good look at it, and you can, yes, you can highlight the Habitats Directive and you can highlight the Waste Directive, but it would be unfair and dishonest of me to say that because of those two directives, that's why we've got the present situation. It's a more subtle process. The Habitats Directive, yes, it says wetlands are a good thing and you should work towards it, but it does state quite clearly that human life, human property, human safety is paramount. It does state that, and nowhere does it say thou shalt not dredge. And I want to be clear about this. It would be lovely for me as a UKIP MEP to be able to say, wave the Habitats Directive at you and say you shall never be dredged, but that isn't quite the case. With the Waste Directive, yes, the default situation is that anything that's classified as waste must go to landfill. However, when this came in, farmers and everybody else had the opportunity just like that. I mean, madness. The water builds up and knocks it straight down. We're wasting money like that, whereas we should be spending it on sensible projects here. So I look at my pet phrase now for what's going on and the way that policies are shaped is that townies are being led by greenies. 100 years ago, we had lions being led by donkeys. It's very similar. We could sort this out. Yes, you may say, well, what's doing this? You've got two elements to this. You've got the amount of water suddenly arriving in these river valleys. Well, that's because we keep concreting and building and concreting and building. So the water, which will always go downhill, is accelerated by all this concrete. So it's arriving more suddenly. And it's accompanied by silt. Well, there's farmers can be responsible for some of that. But also, whenever you drive through any county now, look at the JCB diggers making new roads, all the new houses. They're digging up soil and leaving it exposed over the winter months, and the rain starts to wash that down. And the silt fraction moves very easily. So our human activity is doing this. But we need houses to live in. 4 million people have arrived in Great Britain in the last 10 years. They need houses. That's because of the immigration policy. And, of course, we need to farm our land. We could... I mean, I've been thinking about this. I was a soil and water conservation man in Rhodesia 40 years, whenever it was, in the mid-70s. And I'm thinking to myself, well, hedges planted on contours with banks, some grass margins as well along there would make a great deal of difference. The things we could do without dramatically changing things. Right. Let's talk about the policies. Are we up there? Okay, these are the individuals who got together to see if we could produce our own agriculture policy. As you know, when we joined the EEC in 1972, we went to this CAP, Common Agricultural Policy, and I would be the first to admit, for the first 12 years, it was a bonanza for farmers. Every year, there was a guaranteed price that went up for unlimited production of many, many commodities. And at the same time, as it happened, technology was coming in, and I saw wheat yields double in the space of 5 years. And from 1984 onwards, it's 72 to 84, it went like that, as far as farmers' opinion of it went. 84 hit this plateau, really, or peak, And then it's been on a bit of like that ever since. And now we've got to the CAP reform I'm talking about, where they're trying to get a policy for 28 countries that ranges from farming 200 miles north of the Arctic Circle in Finland down to the bottom corner of Crete. You're looking at 500 metres to fill in a form for exemptions, which the Environment Agency will have done for dredgings. And to date, they have had no problem in getting rid of dredgings anywhere. The big problem for them, though, is the hassle of the paperwork. They have to fill in forms to say exactly what they're going to do, and if they come across any problems, you know, can we put the muck over 3 metres over there, etc., etc. They need to employ a compliance officer, and it's the get up and go that we farmers like to be able to. There's an opportunity to do some dredging. Let's get on with it. You know, I'm sure the farmers of you know the feeling. We can do this today if we get on with it. They can't work like that now in the Environment Agency. They've got to get somebody to agree to it all and tick the right boxes. So what has been going on? 40 years ago, we all understood that if you kept putting silt into a river through your human activities, every now and again you would have to take it out, and if you didn't, you would get problems with flooding. And so nobody disagreed with the principle of dredging. But in the last 40 years, we have had another dynamic coming into it. The anti-dredging fraternity, the greenies, the people who now are starting to tug at the sleeves of government ministers and saying, look, dredging's a bad thing. You're going to kill this species, that species, and the other species. You're going to make these riverbanks look like an ugly great scar across the valley bottom. All these problems you're going to do, you should make these SSSI, special sites of scientific interest, when in fact they're main drainage channels and really have to be looked at from that point of view. Now, these people are very influential. So at the bottom end of the scale, you've got the IDBs, the internal drainage boards, with their farmer members who have stakeholders. They're advised by water engineers. They were the people who in 2000 said we must drain the mouth of this river Parrot. That river Parrot's unusual in that the velocity of the water going out on the tide is less than the velocity of the water when it comes back in again. That means that silt never really gets out properly into the Bristol Channel, so it builds up in the mouth and starts going backwards. So every time you get a really wet event, you put more silt in, it can't get rid of it, the whole river starts to build up. So each time it's a little bit worse than the last time, and you've got less and less river to deal with the whole thing. It really is a nightmare. So they wanted to dredge it in the year 2000. And it was going to cost £4 million. And they could only raise £1 million. The reason for this is that the priorities have been displaced. What once everyone realised, and those who lived down there, was very important to get these rivers dredged. Now, because of all the sleeve tugging and the greenies at the top there, it's being put down the scale. So we give £22 million to Bangladesh to sort out their railways, of which only 10% was spent on any railways. We have NGOs building so-called dams across valleys in Africa, which are the thickness, they're just bricks, like brick wall of this. They need to have a row with their commission to get agreement there, and finally to have a row with us, the MEPs, to get some agreement there. So he invited some of the MEPs from the Parliament to Dublin, which is, of course, is where he lives, along with all the 28 Ministers of Agriculture. And to get us all going, we had a lovely dinner there, and there was an Irish folk rock band playing, and the Minister of Agriculture for Ireland got up onto a table and started dancing to help loosen everybody's tongues, and he did achieve that. And on my table were the Agriculture Minister for Sweden and for Denmark, and they started talking to each other about the reform in English. They saw me listening rather closely, so reverted to a Scandinavian language. He managed to get some agreement there. Then, of course, we had to go to the plenary session, where we had a massive vote there. It was all too much for the Vice President, or the Chairman, or the Speaker, whichever you want to call him. He collapsed during the proceedings. He was in a coma for 3 months, but he is recovering. So we've had a bit of interest along the way. Then to cap it all, the final problem has been the Commission, having had apparently witnessed 3 years of democratic process, have just said, oh, by the way, chaps, we're going to institute delegated acts, it's called. We're effectively the Commissioner writing the text on their proposal in the first place, and to hell with all the amendments, etc. That is rather simplifying it, but we do have a problem with these delegated acts. The Chairman of the Agriculture Committee is a socialist Italian who I actually get on personally with very well. He calls me Agnew, and I call him Chairman, and that's how we go on. And we were going to have yet another emergency meeting with the Commissioner to try and flush him out and draw him out on the delegated acts. And he said, Agnew, let's stay here in the members' bar. We keep the Commissioner waiting. So it's got a little bit childish in that respect. But what are delegated acts? Delegated acts are the power that the Commission has to actually write the text and maybe vary it from what the democratic process threw up. Some of that may be justified, because when you have 8,500 amendments with all the combinations and permutations there are there, you may get ambiguities and contradictions, and the Commission have to try and take a path through that. However, there is no excuse for them suddenly saying, well, it was all agreed, and with the WTO, that sheep on the uplands, there could be individual headage payments on sheep up to certain numbers. The Commission said female sheep. Now, I know that the issue of female rights has been very strong in the Parliament these last 5 years, but I think that's perhaps taken a little bit too far. So I took the opportunity in the plenary chamber to say to the Commissioner, who was down to my left, Commissioner, which of your gang is going to lift the tails of the sheep on the Scottish hills to see whether they're male or whether they're female? And that stung him enough to take it out. So we are left now with a right old muddle, because time is pressing. As MEPs, we cannot amend these delegated acts.